it's better to be born lucky than good looking. You know, I've had my share of luck, but the skill, if you like, if there is any, is taking advantage of that luck.
Barry Hearn is one of the most powerful men in world sport.
Top draw, top draw. He's come from a council estate in Dagenham and he's really built his life up and his career up from nothing.
He's managed some of the biggest sports stars of the last four decades.
Pound for pound, he's delivered more excitement to the punter in the street than any other promoter.
He's transformed working men's pastimes into prime-time TV.
Barry is one of those larger-than-life characters. He's a Jack the Lad.
If Barry was chocolate, he would eat himself. He does love himself.
I'll tell you what, the geezer on the right is better looking than the geezer on the left. I'm a showman. That's what I do.
He's made millions, lost millions, and made millions again.
What a boy, eh?
I'm really proud of everything my dad's done. What you see is what you get.
A wheeler, a dealer, a charmer and a chancer. The boy done good.
Play well.
He's great at making you feel good in yourself.
You cheeky chappy.
He definitely 100% is the people's promoter.
Out of the tree of life, I just picked me a plum.
There's certain times when you look in the mirror and you say to yourself, privately, you know what, you're pretty good. The shoulders go back, the chest comes out and say, Bazza, nice one.
The real good bet, the best is yet to come.
Barry is in the south of France. He's here to make deals and find new buyers for some of the 2,000 hours of televised sport his matchroom company produce every year. He is the ultimate travelling salesman.
But you ain't seen it shine.
Doesn't get much better than this, does it? I mean, this is supposed to be work, you know? So, yeah, fantastic. Obviously, great place. Hub of activity and, you know, this particular trade festival probably represents 80% of your annual business, a bit like Christmas, really, but in the sports business. This is Christmas Day.
We need to come up with probably somewhere around 300,000 US to do a major.
A lot of people accuse me of being a bit of a barrel boy sometimes. Well, this is my element, you know, I can stand up and offer, you know, different deals on different programmes.
The dream is this relationship evolves into a major televised global event.
The workload that he gets through day in, day out is not human.
That's really what I'm after, yeah.
He's always coming up with wacky ideas and you tend to hear the idea and laugh and then you start thinking about it and you think, he might have a point there, you know.
There are areas in Canada...
We start off with the criteria. If I don't like it, we don't do it. I'm sure that'll change when my kids run all the business and I'm sort of somewhere else. But for the moment, if Bazza don't like it, it don't happen.
It's a bit like going to your dentist. You know, the secret of going to your dentist is you grab his testicles and look him in the eyes and say, now, neither of us are going to hurt each other, are we?
Any one year, we will spend a considerable amount of time looking at maybe 5 or 6 new opportunities. And some of the crazier ones, we looked at the World Crazy Golf Championships, you know, and everyone says, well, you can see Tiger Woods playing one off the windmill, you know, things like that. And you say, well, how bizarre would that be, you know, but for one reason or another, it doesn't happen. I mean, currently we're looking at ping pong. I mean, 300 million people play ping pong. Why can't we turn it into the next darts? It's like going to a restaurant. Do we eat the hors d'oeuvre before the main course or do we eat the main course first? And it depends how hungry you are sometimes, and it depends... if you have enough money for the hors d'oeuvre as well.
I know it sounds big-headed, but I think I'm the best.
Thank you very much. Too strong for me.
Thank you.
Every day there's a spring in my step. Every day I'm happy to be alive. And, you know, listen, what type... can I sit here honestly and complain about anything?
Right. Who's next?
Down in the harbour, Barry has hired a boat. He's holding a private party for clients and customers. And helping him charm his guests is one of the top sports stars he manages, darts legend Phil the Power Taylor.
OK, can I wish everyone the best luck, because you know you've got no chance right now. You're now playing at the table with one of the world's greats.
Basically, I'm here to support Barry and, to be honest, have a good time. It's a nice little break for me because I don't get a chance to do things like this. Where would a little council house wallet, you know, be on a nice boat like this? It's unbelievable.
Oh, we've got a pot.
Three players
and a pot.
I don't think I've met a more positive person, definitely, than my dad.
You may need a bit of help here.
I haven't met someone, really, I think, that is more fun to be around. And I think I think probably most people would say that know him as well.
To be honest with you, it's like a man playing with children.
He's great at mingling. He's great at making people feel very, very special. When he grabbed hold to me, I was nothing really, and he made me feel like a world champion. And he's probably one of the only people that's ever done that.
Susan, watch out.
Uh-oh, danger.
I've never seen him down. If I lose a tournament, you know, come on, boy, doesn't matter, we'll win the next one. So you're up all the time, you know, you're always feeling good about yourself.
Camera quick.
He breeds energy in you. And that's why he's been so successful.
Cheerio and come back soon, because you know how much we miss you.
Tonight is all about mixing business with pleasure. Although for the host with the most, there's no difference between the two.
When I was young, I used to lie all the time and I used to make a shed load of money by lying. Now you're old, you tell the truth. And you feel cleansed, you know? In our business, we've been brown-nosing people for so many years, it's a waste of time.
I'm still consider myself working class, you know, I'm a worker. And I don't see why normal, ordinary guys don't rule the world. And that's our aim, you know? I think our sports can take over the world because everybody plays them.
The darts is only 10 years old, but the snooker, 2 years ago, they came to me and said, look, we're not getting anywhere. So I ended up put the deal together and I bought the whole lot.
What's the biggest?
It's the biggest in China.
In China?
It's 100,000 full-time players in China now.
Wow.
There's more snooker clubs in Shanghai than the rest of the world added together.
There may well be thousands of snooker clubs in China, but the most important one for Barry is tucked away in Romford in Essex. The decision to buy this place in the mid-70s would change his life forever.
Fate's a very strange thing, you know. Certain things just seemed destined to happen. You know, I don't know why. I'd never played snooker before. I'd never held a snooker cue. I bought the snooker halls actually as a property investment.
Right. Morning, morning.
But as soon as I bought them, the BBC put snooker onto mainstream television and suddenly there's queues of people trying to play snooker. And everyone said to me, you're a genius, how did you do it? Do you know what? It was just pure luck. Right place, right time is so much more important than being brain of Britain. Misspent youth? I don't think so.
It wasn't long before he began promoting his own events, attracting players from all over the southeast, including a tongue-tied teenager from London.
The balls in the holes bit is where you get the points from.
OK. I'll
smash them up.
Well, no respect.
Well.
Yeah, that's a typical Davis safety shot.
The best things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees.
The cream on the cake was when the best player in the world walked in and said, can I play in one of your competitions? And at the time, I had no idea how good he was. Of course, I didn't know anything about snooker. All I saw was someone who was young, very dedicated, you know, totally devoid of personality,
here we
charisma.
Go, here we go, here
no, actually,
we
nothing's
go.
Actually, nothing's changed. Here nothing's we changed.
Actually, this is giving me hope. You are proving that I'm actually quite good.
Do you know, I might take this game up.
No, don't take it up.
I was a pretty shy young lad with a snooker cue, and Barry came along, and obviously he was the market salesman, brash, you know, a bit of a geezer and a bit like that. But, funnily enough, you could be in awe of Barry if you've not met him. But usually, once you meet him, you realise there's a genuine enthusiasm there that rubs off on you.
In those early days, we were a sort of marriage made in heaven because Steve had the ability, I had the front, and I never, ever, in 35 years, told this man what ball he should pot next.
And well, you can see why.
And I don't think he's ever told me, you know, what deal I should do next.
Every day of his life, he's always been enthusiastic. And you can't help but be carried along downstream with him. And so, in the dressing room, in between events, matches, great person to have in your corner. You walked out, you had steam coming out your nostrils, and you were fired up because he was fired up.
I'm sure as the years go by, you will see him, as I hope to, where the world cracked.
Steve and I would sit and discuss what it's going to be like to win the world title. And we would plan what's the speech afterwards and how's it going to be and what's the opportunities that will exist. We would have tears, literally tears rolling down our cheeks, thinking of it, the emotion of actually achieving your goal. We were so committed to winning.
He's breathing heavily as he comes down to this final pink. And that's it. The world snooker champion, 1981, Steve Davis.
He got down on this straight pink, and the next thing I knew was the pink was in the hole, and I was hitting him with almost a rugby tackle that would have knocked most people over. And I can't describe the feeling. To this day, I get a lump in my throat thinking about it. It was the best feeling. Amazing emotion. And it was like us against the world. The boys have done good.
I think I was in the back snivelling and there's Barry giving it everything to it. But that was like, he was like that. It was just absolutely 100% all the time.
I mean, there was a closed shop in snooker 30 years ago, you know, and sort of this upstart comes in with a loudmouth manager and, you know, what do they know? You know, well, actually, we know how to win and we'll show you and everybody else, you know, that this is the start of a new era.
I'm a hustler, baby.
The man who manages Steve Davis and two other giants of the Green Bays, Terry Griffiths and Tony Meo, is Barry Hearn, known justifiably as snooker's Mr. Big. My dad is me.
It was an evolution, you know. I mean, you have to bear in mind that I had no idea what I was doing.
Hello.
Everything was like Columbus.
Dale, how are you?
We were finding things out about ourselves and about the industry. Daily, hourly sometimes.
Well done, Terry. Well done, my son.
Snooker's popularity went through the roof. Only royal weddings, soap operas and the odd sitcom attracted more TV viewers. In 1985, over 18 million tuned in to see Dennis Taylor dramatically snatch the world crown.
He's done it!
Barry, after I beat Steve Davis, signed me up, which was quite amazing. But at the time, he was the main man, and he was looking after Steve Davis, Terry Griffiths, Tony Mayo, Jimmy White, I mean, Willie Thorne, all the ones that featured on Snooker Loopy with Chaz and Dave.
Snooker Loopy, nuts are we, me and him and them and me.
The nation went nuts over snooker. It even had its own sing-along soundtrack, with Barry conducting the unlikeliest boy band ever assembled.
I went to the filming of it at my dad's office. I've got a very vivid recollection of Tony Meo with a big plate of pasta. I think it's great. I love it. I love it for my dad that he got to sort of be on Top of the Pops and everything.
It was a superstar treatment that ordinary blokes can only dream about. And in those days, all the snooker players, we were living the dream. And we made loads of money, but we didn't stop laughing.
I'll celebrate and buy another
hairbrushes for me bonnet.
We did a variety of matchroom products, which I look back on now, it was frightening, really, so frightening. I mean, I cringed at the matchroom slippers.
It's wild, you know, and hey, we'll do some silly things. Let's create our own fragrance.
The matchroom aftershave was, you know, moving on into another level. For me, it was, yeah, I thought we were getting a bit poncy by that time, moving into that world.
We'll show you what we can do with a...
Building those personalities. This was all part of a plan. You know, we got everybody together and, you know, I can remember saying to Terry Griffiths, you know, you're Welsh, you just sing a lot.
His manager and all said, take that ball, man.
Dennis, you tell jokes, so you're the funny Irishman.
We don't care who wins this year,
cos he's got the rest of us signed up.
And Steve, you're the boring one. You just sip water. And so they all created a character, and then it became like a soap opera. It was almost Coronation Street with balls.
Meet Willie Thorne, snooker's maximum man with an astonishing 62 maximum breaks to his credit. Jimmy White, snooker's wild man, and probably the most naturally gifted player in the professional snooker world.
He managed me twice for two lots of 5 years at a time. You know, I was a bit of a lad in them days, and sometimes he couldn't find me. He was always saying to me, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? And, you know, we'd be pals all the time.
People criticise Matcham like they criticise Everton and Liverpool. The thing is that it's all down to winning, and that's what we've done all year. And that's what we're going to do next year and the year after and the year after that.
With his stable of stars dominating the game, he was now the most powerful man in snooker and the most outspoken.
Well, everybody within the game, other than the people that Barry was managing and promoting, hated him with a passion. because he was coming out with things they didn't want to hear.
The role I see for the Matchroom professionals, other than hopefully winning everything and continually to spread the game across the world, is almost to act as a watchdog. And if we feel the governing body's making mistakes, just have a little discussion with them.
Barry's style would be too brash for some people. He was also treading on the patch of our association by putting events on, and they started to sort of put up barriers against him progressing within the game.
This is serious business, you know. I mean, there's a lot of money here, and we're talking about things like splitting up prize money, and this room's, apart from myself, of course, where they'll gross £2.5 million this season.
We had years of dominance, and followed by lots of problems with the governing body that didn't really want me to be in business. They wanted to do it themselves. Unfortunately, they didn't have the ability to do it themselves. After a while, because of my personality and nature, I wanted to do other things as well as snooker. And in the sort of middle to late 80s, I decided, you know what? I think I'll be a boxing promoter.
White Hart Lane claims its place in British boxing history by staging the richest ever fight held in Europe. Frank Bruno versus Joe Buckner, a £3 million bonanza that's about to happen.
Having conquered snooker, boxing was next on Barry's hit list. His first venture into the fight game was to set up a heavyweight battle of epic proportions.
Decided if I was going to do it, I'd got to do something big. My ego wouldn't let me do anything small. So, the ultimate ticket-selling fight. Everybody loved Frank Bruno. Everybody hated Joe Buckner. And, you know, it made a lot of money.
Barry offered us the fight, and I didn't believe him, you see. I didn't think he could deliver.
Greg Dyke was really funny, you know. He's the only man in my life that ever, in television, paid me more than I asked for because he didn't believe I could deliver.
He said we could have it for £200,000, which I thought was... If he could get it for £200,000, it was a steal. My worry was that he couldn't get it. So I offered him more. I said, look, if you can get this, I'll give you more than that. I'll give you £250,000.
And he's going to let him box on, and he's pinned in Bruno's corner, and it won't go surely now.
I pride myself on always delivering.
The towel has come in from the Australian's corner.
When I say something, wrong or right, I honestly believe that. And when I give you my hand, you take my heart. With me, a contract is fine. But if I give my word to something, I would rather die than lose that.
A quarter of a century on from that first fight, Barry is still heavily involved in the sport.
Dressing room's upstairs?
Yeah.
The fighters' dressing room's upstairs?
Yes.
He's managed more than 30 world champions and promoted over 500 fights. And in that time, he's not taken too many wrong turns.
Sorry. I think it must be this one. Who's in where?
He understands how to make something seem exciting. He understands that having an event in itself isn't enough. You have to build it up and you have to make it into a spectacular.
Well, it's good performance. So far, good performance. Well done.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Now, you've got plenty in the crowd with you, son. And box well, yeah?
He understands what the public, particularly the male public, will watch. And that was always the genius, really.
One of the most successful ideas to shake up boxing has been Prize Fighter. It's an eight-man contest fought over one night of three-round bouts, with the last man standing picking up a big check. The punters may love it, but the purists are not so sure.
It's just something I've never got into, though I've had two boxers who've gone and won Prize Fighter and both won £32,000 each, and obviously I've taken my management percentage, so I have earned out of it. But to me, it's not boxing. It's not what a traditional boxing person likes, and I'm a traditional boxing person.
Everyone's always said, oh, I know your father, I worked with him for years. Wow, he's one of the straightest men in boxing. And that's actually quite nice to hear. And that's something he's always installed in us, you know, all that whole time, is, you know, do things properly, be upfront with people, tell them the truth. Nothing can ever come back to us.
I've always found it to be fair. If he says he's going to pay me a pound, he'll pay me a pound. If he makes a pound and 20p, you know, that's down to him. He doesn't tell you about the 20p, he tells you about the pound. He's promised you. But everything he's always he always says he does deliver. That I will say about him, unlike a lot of other people in boxing.
I know to beat him, but we're making that.
Another three rounds might have been a different
once
you close that distance on him.
I always wanted to be heavyweight champion of the world when I was a youngster. I just unfortunately had no ability, but I never lost my love of the sport and my respect for the people that do it, because it is the toughest game of all.
I felt that. It put me right off my pork pie.
You know, and even today, you know, we look forward to the careers of some of the young fighters we've got. And when I think about it, I'm buzzing. We'll be in Vegas. We're going to take the title. We're going to beat up everybody. We're going to rock the world.
Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my pants. Put suckers in beer.
Back in the early 90s, Barry was the king of British boxing, managing the most explosive talent of the era, Christopher Livingstone Eubank. As he had done with Davis in snooker, he formed a very close bond with his latest sporting protégé. It proved to be an intense relationship.
I loved Eubank, no question. I think he's a very special guy. I mean, he's infuriating, he's eccentric, slightly mad, but I would not have swapped a minute with Chris Eubank.
I don't know if Barry really knows it, but I think I actually discovered Chris Eubanks. His first couple of fights were on my shows, and he came to see me, and we fell out over a cup of Earl Grey tea. He wanted Earl Grey tea, and I only had ordinary tea in the office. And next thing I knew, he signed with Barry Hearns, and, you know, him and Barry were a good partnership. You had the showman, and you had the ringmaster.
Ronnie Davis was Eubank's trainer. I think it's fair to say, Ronnie Davis and me would have taken a bullet for Eubank on the way into the ring. Now, that's an intensity that sounds simple, but I'm serious. We would have taken a bullet for that man.
This man is somehow, I think, his heart is good. I don't know why it's good. I mean, you don't find promoters with a good heart. They usually use fighters as meat. This man gives a fair deal.
The Hearn name continues to be a powerful and influential one in the sport, but it's son Eddie who is now the more prominent promoter in boxing.
I'm always going to be Barry Hearn's son. That's fine, I'm proud to be it. But what he's always instilled in me is a working-class attitude, and that's something that will never leave me. So I get up every morning, you know, I spend time with my daughter, I go to work, I work my cods off all day. Advice comes from him all the time. You know, he always says to me, which is something that always stands out to me in business, is always leave a little bit of bread in the fish's mouth. You know, and that sometimes, you know, greed is a very dangerous thing, not just in business but in life, and it just makes you think, yeah, maybe you're right, you know. Don't just go for the kill straight off.
Like Barry, the business has come a long way.
Yeah, but we've got our very high standards, and if the team we've got don't come up with those standards, then we change the team.
Set up in an office beneath Romford Snooker Club back in 1982, Matchroom Sport is now based in the Essex mansion where his children Katie and Eddie grew up. And he is aiming to keep it in the family as he begins to hand over the reins.
Just drop a note to Art Palulu and say, dear Art, what are you doing with Pirog? Question mark. I mean, there's high standards because Dad did it from nothing. And it's a tough one for them to come in and say, now you take it to the next level. But I think it's always tough for kids to follow in their father's footsteps, you know, who's done pretty good for a youngster from nowhere.
Not quite nowhere. Blitz-damaged Dagenham was where Barry came into the world on the 19th of June, 1948. Dad Morris was a bus conductor, while Mum Barbara cleaned people's houses for a living. Younger sister Christine completed the Hearn family picture. In this age of austerity, money was always tight, despite Barry's best efforts.
I always had aspirations. I always wanted a big house on the hill. I was never frightened to go to work. So I started about 13 years old stripping tomato plants, and then I built up a car washing round, window cleaning round, babysitting round, gardening round, worked with other kids and organised various ways of making money, you know.
One
My mother told me when I was 12, when you grow up, you're going to be a chartered accountant. And I said, what do they do, Mum? And she said, I haven't got a clue. But the man whose house I clean says, you never see a poor one. She was the driving force in my life, really. And, you know, she was the one that locked me in my bedroom at night when I was studying for my accountancy exams and wouldn't let me out. So I grew up in that society where my father never taught me too much, but one phrase he did give me was make every day count. And I've lived on that ever since. Every day, I work as if it's my last day.
In 1966, Barry met Susan, and 4 years later, the recently qualified accountant married his glamorous fiancée. Two children, Katie and Eddie, followed, and they remain very close, despite the odd fallout. Going to get
to London. When I was born, you know, my mum went into labour, and he dropped her off at the hospital and said he'd be back later, and went to Romford Snooker Club and played a guy called Chunky Warne for a fiver or something, and the hospital called the snooker club to tell him that I was being born, but he said it was a best of three and it was 1-1. We couldn't go anywhere. And then turned up at the hospital and she was being wheeled out, and he looked at her and he said, good luck, darling. And she says, I've already had him. Consider yourself one of us.
I'm really proud of everything my dad's done, not just in terms of business, but I'm really proud of him as a person.
You know, I'm a father now and I'm quite hands-on as a father, and he always takes the mickey out of me, you know, if I'm changing a nappy, or he can't understand what's going on here. Or if I tell him I'm in Tesco's buying some dinner, he just can't understand all that, because as far as he's concerned, you know, that's a woman's job and the man provides the money.
Remind us, we got to talk to those lads that drive the van for the PGA Euro Pro Tour. I want them to go to Faro.
We're all very loud people, so sitting together around a table, I think, is hilarious fun. We're all trying to talk over each other. Everyone wants to tell their own story. Everyone wants to be heard. Often we're literally waiting for a gap in the conversation to get our story in quickly before, like, Dad or Ed will want to say their story.
In March 1995, another chapter in his remarkable sporting life began when he bought Leighton Orient. The East End football club he'd supported as a boy had fallen on hard times.
I think it's really important to know where you come from. I come from around here, and this is my football club. I usually keep my heart opposite my wallet, and that day they merged. I just thought, I was there when I was 11. You just don't forget those things.
When he first took Leighton Orient, he sent a letter asking me if I'd like to donate £50,000 to Leighton Orient and become on their board of directors and go to all the games. I could go in a boardroom and have a sandwich with Barry and have a cup. And I'm thinking, is this guy mad? But he's a salesman, isn't he? That's what he does. And I wrote back, I'm Millwall through and through. And I just posted it back to him.
Football is full of people with fur coats and no knickers, you know? Well, that's not here. Here we live in the real world. You know, I've never really liked government intervention, but probably I can make a case that they should intervene in football, because I think it's out of control. Clubs spending money they don't have, players earning a disproportionate salary with regard to what's happening in the real world. Football is not necessarily just about money.
He's transformed Orient's financial fortunes with the help of some astute property deals. But now he believes there is a new threat on the horizon, with local rivals West Ham United a potential occupier of the nearby Olympic Stadium.
You know, we have a struggle going on with the Olympic Stadium, which has been well publicised. We have the prospect of a massive club moving closer to us and taking away our fan base. And, you know, no one seems to care, really. And that's very worrying.
Whoever moves in next door to Orient, Barry will stand up for his club. Throughout his career, he's had his fair share of fights, although his biggest battle came in the early 1990s when Matchroom was on the brink of going bust.
I think, you know, recessions always give businesses like mine a problem if you're not established. And certainly in the 90s, 1990, 1991 time was the toughest I've known. You know, there were plenty of times where I wondered, how can we pay the wages?
As a child, you just think everything's rosy. Only now you sort of hear the stories and think, well, I didn't know that, you know, were we really? Blimey. You know, so, but those sort of times are important to remember, and he's always sort of instilled that in us, that things can go wrong at any time.
I had a major sponsor went bust on me and cost me a lot of money, which we paid, and we worked through it, but it was 2 years of making you appreciate the good times.
For us as a family, I don't know, I think we're quite kind of tough nuts, really. Like, you know, you pick yourself up as a family, and, you know, every family has things to deal with, and you just sort of stick close together and keep going, really.
I've always known Barry to be reasonably rich, shall we say. If he was going skint, you'd never know. He is a typical salesman, always got a nice suit on, always got a nice smile, always let's eat in the best places. So you would never know.
I grafted. I grafted every day. I knocked on more doors than a travelling salesman. And I refused to accept that I was going to be in trouble. You know, it was a very good time for character building and find out a little bit about yourself rather than other people. And although it sounds big-headed, I liked what I found out.
How high is the water, Mama? 2 feet high and rising.
It's not all work and no play for Barry, although he does make an art form of mixing the two. To relax, he loves nothing more than a spot of fishing in the grounds of his Essex home, listening to country and Western music as he sits in his favourite old rocking chair.
There's only carp in this lake, so 61 carp, all of them related to me. They're all my friends. It's a sad life. Everyone is tagged. I have a scanner here, so I can tell each fish over the years how much weight they put on. They're all named after friends of mine. And I can recognise them now. I write everything down. You know, typical accountant, sad person. I write every day's fishing down, so I look back on year after year how the weight's progressed. Oh, Barry, that is so good. It starts in 07, and every computer tags there the original weight, the name of the fish, the type of the fish. It's like creating another family.
How high's the water, Mama?
People come here and fish, and when they catch one, they get to name a fish. The power, Davis. Steve's kids, Greg and Jack. Even Michelle, my PA's got one.
Chickens are sleeping in the willow trees. Cows in water up.
I get people say to me now, you know, how am I doing? What do I weigh? Say, you're a fat.
How high's the water, Mama? 4 feet high and rising.
If you're talking about relaxing and you're talking about creative thinking, this is the place most of it's happened. And in a way, whereas I owe Steve Davis an enormous debt for what he's added to my life and other great sportsmen as well, Phil Taylor and Chris Eubank, in a way I perhaps owe fishing more even than I owe to them. Most of my good ideas come when I'm pure of thought down at the lake.
It's the biggest prize in angling history, and it's happening right here at Mallory Park in the heart of England.
He's hooked in many with his ideas over the years, but few as bizarre as this one.
When he first came to me with fishing, I didn't buy it. I said, look, Barry, I go fishing. I said, you know, in course fishing especially. It's a bunch of guys, mine mainly, sitting by a bank waiting for something to happen. How do you turn that into a spectator event? He did it.
You know, one good fish would win it for Lou, but he's got to get it in. Has he got time?
Fishermania was invented at a carp lake in Ockenden the day after WrestleMania. That's where the name came from.
I went to see David Hill, who was running Sky at the time, said, David, I think fishing. He said, I like it. I said, I need 6 hours live. He said, you're mad.
Oh, dear, look at his face. Look
this
at his
Dickie
face.
This is Dickie Carr, our leader.
Unbelievable.
Tremendous tension here.
There's thousands sit around and watch blokes going like this. Now, how you sell that? He could sell anything to anybody, I think.
What's this? Has Dickie got one? Oh, it looks as though he's had one and lost one.
Oh, no.
Those guys, when they fish, are so good. They're as good as Tiger Woods when he plays golf.
We're 60 seconds away from the final hooter here at Fishermania. And Turner, who has finished so strongly, is that his fourth in the last 10
minutes? That's his fourth in the last 10 minutes.
there isn't any other fishing on telly of the sort that we do with Barry. And, you know, Fisher Mania for a whole day is a fabulous watch. So, yes, the skills of Barry, but, you know, let's not forget, he picked up in it on the back of huge participation. He knew there was a market there.
19 years later, it's the biggest fishing competition in the world. And for an angler to appear even at the final establishes Bankside credibility for life.
Aside from fishing, he's helped revitalise a whole host of sports and bring them to a wider TV audience. His methods may sometimes be controversial, but he understands the needs of broadcasters, particularly those with hours of programming to fill.
He comes up with a million ideas and he wants us to partner him in taking on every single one of them. Some you'll chew the fat and you'll decide that's not for us. But that won't stop him coming back again and just saying, come on, we can really make this work. So he can make a really persuasive case.
If he can see an angle and he can see a dollar sign at the end of it, he'll create something.
You only have to look at darts, you only have to look at snooker, you have to look at everything. Boxing that he gets involved with, he's got a really successful hit rate.
In 2001, Barry brought his unique management style to yet another sport. As chairman of the Professional Darts Corporation, his innovations have turned it into one of the unlikeliest success stories of the last decade.
I am still a control freak, and I still hate committees. I still believe in myself as almost the benevolent despot of sport.
I love that quote.
I am the best in the world at what I do, in my opinion, which is the only opinion that I actually value.
The sport he calls working-class golf now regularly fills 10,000-seater stadia, and the ultimate working man's game attracts fans from all walks of life. The Queen's granddaughter, Zara Phillips, is the latest convert, turning up at the 2012 World Final.
I think you'll have a special night, if you've not been before. But I wouldn't recommend you hold any signs up, because it's a real giveaway, you know?
Yeah. I think, you know, as far as his greatest achievements have to be, I think darts has to be right up there, because when you go to a darts event and you look round at the atmosphere, you simply cannot fathom how this possibly happened. You know, darts is a great game, but it's been around for years and no one's really embraced it. But the atmosphere and the environment and the entertainment factor that he's brought into the game is amazing.
Anyway, listen, you play well tonight, young man.
All right. Thank you.
Play well.
Thank you.
See you later, boy.
Since he came into darts, the prize money has rocketed from $500,000 to over £5 million a season. For players such as Adrian Jackpot Lewis and Andy the Hammer Hamilton, it's a path to undreamed of riches.
Yeah, play well. Whatever happens.
I'm still a winner.
Do what you do best.
Yep.
Don't give an inch and growl a lot.
Not at all.
A guy that spends 6 hours a day on the hockey learning his trade is as much a sportsman as any gold medal winner in the Olympics. But keep a secret?
Yeah. I can.
Someone's just walked into a betting shop and had £50,000 in cash on Andy Hamilton to win.
Really?
Yeah.
Amazing.
Do you know who it was?
I hope it wasn't Andy. The actual job we've done on darts, come from absolutely nowhere, has been one of the most motivating things in my life. A lot of it is just old techniques that I've used all my life. You make the players famous.
It's hammer time! Andy Hamilton!
Create an atmosphere that is conducive to people just to forget about all their problems and enjoy themselves.
That's Barry Hearn's trick, really, is to take pub games or sort of marginal pastimes and turning them into genuinely competitive sports or certainly events and getting people really, really interested. And he really, really has a knack for it.
I would say the history of sport, the reinvention of darts, is probably one of the greatest things that's happened in sport, because it was a sport that was seen as a bit dying and it was, you know, blokes with fags and beer. Now it's bloke with fags and beer that aren't allowed on stage with fags and beer, but, you know, it's just, the event's fantastic.
100.
got an idea.
Go on, what's this?
You should have, like, you know, like the baseball gloves.
Yeah.
With 180 on.
The baseball glove.
Have you been in
promotions?
Can we have a quick
picture?
Have you been in promotions for long?
No.
Okay.
He's very outspoken, he's very honest, and he'll say what he thinks and what he feels. And sometimes that's not always, you know, the general opinion. So sometimes he can be controversial, but he's genuinely just saying what he believes in. And most of the time, that's generally for the good of the sport that he's involved in, trying to move that forward.
The punters are the ones that tell you if you've got something worthy, something that adds to their life. Most people's life's fairly mundane. My job as a sports promoter is give them moments that they go to work thinking, oh, I had a cracking night last night.
Well done, girls, well done. Take the rest of the night off. I mean, listen, I love my job. If this is work, I don't know what work, hard work is. All right, boy, well done. Great winner, great event, and 50,000 punters going home with a smile on their face, having been royally entertained. That's my job.
So it's another event over and time for a chill out down by the lake. It takes a lot to knock Barry off his stride. A heart attack in 2001 briefly stopped him in his tracks. But while his workload remains prolific, he always takes time now to unwind.
When he had his heart attack many years ago, I think that might have put a little different slant on his life. You know, I think in the early days, when things were tight here and tough here, I think, obviously, that was a very stressful period. But certainly in the last 15 years, and as every day goes on, I see him care less about the worry and the panic and just really understanding what matters in life and what doesn't matter. And business matters, but family matters more.
This is my other house, I suppose. It's a bit smaller. I sleep there if I fish all night. I wake up in the morning and cook my breakfast. No one disturbs me. And every now and again we get some friends down and we fish for the trophy. And it's very competitive, but, you know, this is an escape from the real world.
I think he's probably mellowed a little bit the last couple of years. He probably fishes a bit more, sort of relaxed a little bit more and spending a bit more time at home, but he's still got the same work ethic that he's always had.
You come down here with no emails, no phones, no one disturbing you, no one giving you grief. And as you get older, you start appreciating your environment a little bit more. I've often thought if we could get the kids in the streets in the inner cities to go fishing, there would be a lot less trouble in the world.
Now he seems to just have this attitude of everything's going to be all right, nothing's a problem. Just, you know, and that puts everyone at ease, and that's a real great talent to have.
He may be more relaxed, but there's no sign of him slowing down.
Well, we're going downstairs.
And as he approaches pension age, Barry finds himself running the sport where it all began.
He's not really the kind of person you could tell to slow down. I mean, you know, he puts so much passion into everything. It's actually quite fun to be around. I don't really want him to sort of slow down. That's what drives him and that's what fires him.
He's got a pickup trophy. It weighs a ton. Yeah, yeah.
When you're laying out on that slab, don't have any regrets. Don't use that word if I'd have done this, I should have done that, maybe. I hate these words. You know, I want people who are definite. I want people who are explosive. And if you make a bad call, make it 100%. Don't make it 50%. So don't start looking over your shoulder and saying, oh, I should have done it. Do it or shut up.
Hi, Barry.
How are you?
Tell us about yourself. Barry, you know this, Q-Zone?
Yeah.
Anything to improve it, the lighting?
I'm sure there's loads we can improve it.
Cheers, Barry.
But we're constantly thinking about it. Where are we going?
From the peak of its popularity in the 1980s, snooker was a sport in decline. In 2009, the players invited Barry to run the game. And he made it clear from the start it would be his way or no way.
Arms first, and then handshake second. You'll get the hang of this.
The game was so moribund, so defunct of ideas, so lacking innovation. And I thought to myself, this is an opportunity, a game fate has dealt me, which would be a sin to turn away from.
I think he truly thought that snooker was dying and it was dead. But then all of a sudden, I think he spotted
how much interest there was worldwide.
So my report finished with, in my view, I should take over the game. And fortunately, just enough players agreed with me.
What he's done for snooker has been amazing. You know, it was that bad I went in the jungle 4 years ago, and now he's got it as up to the top sport it should be.
Why are the crowds up? Is it down to the marketing, or is it down to Judd Trump coming along at the same time?
It's a little bit of both, but yeah. Mainly it's the king has no clothes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If people believe things are happening,
yeah.
The average panel will go along and have a look at it.
Yeah.
And actually, when they go and look at it, they say, it's been quite a good night.
I've really enjoyed myself with the snooker. I mean, it's been so much fun because I've been able to just blow it all up and start again. You know, it was a sport that really wasn't going anywhere. But there was a lethargy in the sport. And, well, we've just taken hold of it and dragged it screaming in the 21st century.
Please welcome Sean the Magician Murphy!
Barry introduced the walk-on music. I think that's great. Great for the game. They've had it in darts and that. I think something a little bit different. There's nothing wrong with it.
The thunder from down under, Neil Robertson!
I think there's been a buzz about the game, without a doubt. Obviously, we've seen many more events put on throughout the whole world. Obviously, new events, high-speed events with more crowd participation. So, yeah, I mean, it's what the game needed. The game needed a sort of kick up the backside.
Excellent. Nice intros.
In recent months, there have been signs of dissent in the ranks. Mark Allen was fined after complaining about the changes being made and declared snooker was going to pot. He even called for Barry to resign.
Mark Allen did speak out at the UK Championship, and he did say that a lot of other players were feeling the same. So Mark was the spokesman. Pretty brave of him to take Barry on, but that's how he felt.
We need people that make headlines. Now, it's got to be, obviously, with some common sense involved as well. I often engage my mouth before I concentrate on my brain. You know, this is a failing.
I know a few of the players have been moaning a little bit about the PTC events, especially the first prize is £10,000. People like Ronnie O'Sullivan, you know, he'd have to give up a weekend and, you know, he'd probably have to win the tournament to break even. So it's trying to reach a happy medium, but they've certainly got plenty of snooker to play, that's for sure.
I think we got into a rut of having only six or seven or eight tournaments in every season, and we got used to that. Now we've gone from one extreme to the other. I mean, there's talk of a tournament every other week somewhere in the world. You know, physically, you can't keep doing that because you're going to get burned out eventually.
I never have any sympathy for anyone who goes to work. You know, I have sympathy for those that can't go to work or can't find a job. So professional sportsmen saying to me, I'm too busy, really falls on a deaf ear.
Your champion, Neil Robertson.
Please tell me I don't have to go to Condon Park tomorrow morning.
You do.
All the players realise that I don't think he really cares what our opinions are about most things. He's just going to do it, what he thinks is best for the game. So we've just got to be along for the ride, basically.
The champion has to be at Crondon Park Golf Course tomorrow at 12 o'clock playing. When he came over, he said, please tell me I don't have to be at Crondon Park tomorrow. I said, afraid you do. I'm never going to do everything that pleases everybody because that would be unnatural, but I'm doing things that please the sport.
Well, he gets fined if he doesn't turn up, so he knows, you know, yeah, he's got to do.
So far, you know, it's not 10 out of 10. It's 9.5. I'm getting the other half next year.
The trouble is we didn't have that BGC logo on the baby. I've told you about that.
He'll think of that in the morning.
Will he turn it around? Guaranteed he'll turn it around, and the snooker players of the next generation will have a far higher prize pool to play for.
If snooker has a chance of succeeding, then Barry's the right man. Whether snooker has a chance, I'm not utterly convinced. The world is possibly too quick now for snooker.
One more beer and a glass of red wine, please. Snooker is a part of my life that I think I can do something for, and it'll do something for me. It keeps me alive. If I was any better, I would fail a drugs test. It keeps me wanting to go to work every morning earlier and work later. You know, that's the best way to cure a recession. Just work longer hours. It works. So the future's looking good, and There'll be a few bumps along the way. There'll be a few people disagreeing with me. That's OK. We can all disagree. We'll have a chat about it, and then we'll do what I want. It's my life,
and it's now. Right then, snooker fans, the world final continues next on BBC Two. Ronnie O'Sullivan against Ali Carter, live from the Crucible. It's my life. It's my life.